Well, this coming Sunday will mark 10 years since anyone has seen or heard anything from a woman named Maura Murray.
Now, the college student crashed her car on Route 112 in North Haverhill, 140 miles north of the UMass Amherst campus that she had left just a few hours earlier. Maura had vanished when police arrived. There was what appeared to be wine in a soda bottle in her car and other indications that she may have been running away. But her father and investigators think there is much more to her disappearance. Heather Hamill revisits the mystery.
It's like it's yesterday to me, and it always will be, I guess, until I find out what exactly happened. And blink of an eye, gone.
10 years and no answers. Fred Murray will never forget the night he got life-changing news. His 21-year-old daughter, Maura, had crashed her car in North Haverhill, but she wasn't at the crash scene. The mystery of what happened to her has plagued Fred ever since.
My initial thought is still what I think, and that's somebody locally grabbed her, knows the area, knows where to go, how to get in someplace and out of someplace and without being seen.
A decade later, Fred still makes regular trips to the area on Route 112 where Maura was last seen.
I go up when there's something to look for, or when I have an idea, or when I've heard something, or when there's somebody to talk to.
A worn blue ribbon wraps the tree that Maura's car hit. The family planned to put a new one up this week. The constant media attention has stopped. The searches have ended, but those who were living in town in the winter of 2004 still remember.
There was no tracks or anything in the woods or anything like that in the snow, so she had to have stayed on the road.
I never had that feeling that it was a local person. You know, I always felt as though she was in the wrong place at the wrong time and somebody came along.
Many others feel Maura Murray is still out there, alive and well, having orchestrated her own disappearance. Search the internet and you'll find a number of blogs about Maura filled with theories and speculation.
Our office and the state police do receive some information from people. Unfortunately, none of that has turned out to be fruitful. We haven't received any credible sightings of Maura since the night she disappeared.
That night was February 9th, 2004. Police got two calls from two residents reporting a car off the road, the first at 727. A local bus driver later told investigators he saw a woman standing outside the black Saturn. An officer arrived at 7:46, finding the car locked and nobody around. The mystery goes beyond those 19 minutes. Nobody is exactly sure why the UMass Amherst nursing student left college and was traveling north in the first place.
I don't know why she went. I don't know the combination of circumstances and events. I may never know. I probably won't.
What we do know is that Fred Murray was in Amherst, Massachusetts, visiting his daughter 2 days before she vanished. She borrowed his car to go to a party and struck a guardrail. No tickets were issued, but there was $8,000 in damage to the car. 3 months earlier, Maura was arrested for using a stolen credit card number for fast food orders. That charge was dismissed as long as she kept good behavior. Her father says he doesn't believe speculation that either incident had anything to do with her disappearance. The day before she left campus, Maura searched directions to Burlington, Vermont, which were found in the car. On February 9th, she sent an email to teachers saying that there had been a death in the family and she'd be away. Maura packed her car, withdrew money, and bought alcohol, including a box of wine that was found in the wrecked car. She made a call to Stowe, but never made reservations. She also called for information on a condominium in Bartlett where she had stayed with her family. Fred thinks that's why she was on Route 112.
It's a road to Bartlett where I'm sure she was going because she knows it like her backyard, because we were in New Hampshire so much, at least 4 times a year. She was up there every year of her life.
Fred has been publicly critical of the investigation, taking the state to court for access to Maura's case file. To this day, most of the documents remain sealed.
I've been asking for the FBI for 10 years to enter the case. I'm still asking today, right now, as I sit here, I'm asking for the FBI to enter the case. It's the only way this case will be solved.
The case has been investigated by the Attorney General's Office and the New Hampshire State Police, and there hasn't been a need to bring in another agency full-time, although the FBI has lended assistance in the past.
That night, police cleared the scene 1 hour and 40 minutes after arriving. Fred thinks they waited too long for a full search, something some neighbors agree with.
There was no one looking for her along the roadway during the daylight hours. for several days. I never saw anyone come down this way, not ever.
I want to know what happened in the first 36 hours. I want to know what their guy did, what the state police officer at the scene did.
So many questions unanswered. Most of all, Fred says he wants his daughter back.
I think that if Maura were alive, she'd have called me. And if not me, one of her sisters, or maybe one of her really good friends. I think she'd have called me. I want to know what happened to my daughter. I want to know who did it. That's what I want.
The Attorney General's office says not all adult missing persons cases are concerning, but given the circumstances, this is very concerning. And that's why there's been an ongoing criminal investigation. They say while it's possible that Maura Murray is still out there somewhere, it's not very likely. In the studio, Heather Hamill, WMUR News 9.